Visioning campaign, which is coming up on the 18th from 12:30 to probably about 4:30. We will feed you, don't worry. But I invite you all to come out. Any of you who have interest in the future of this church, what you'd like to see us doing, where your interests are, where your passion are, we want to uncover that and try to build something new for the future of Smithfield. So I invite you to come out to that. If you want to RSVP, you can RSVP to the office with Sean to let us know how many are coming so we can expect, you know, a number for lunch. If there are no other announcements, let us hear today's call to worship. This is the day the Lord has made.
Praise the Lord.
The Lord saw your suffering and heard your cries.
Praise the Lord.
The Lord saved you from death.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Our first hymn is hymn number 277, Holy, Holy, Holy.
Thank you.
these words of invocation. O God, from your providing hand, even the dissatisfied and grumbling receive what they need for their lives. Teach us your ways of justice and lead us to practice your generosity so that we may live a worthy life of the gospel. May know through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. You know, we continue to believe that we must earn our way into God's heart, but God's grace is given to us. I now invite you to say with me the prayer of confession printed in your bulletin. It seems we cannot decide the cloud of glory.
We say we will live to serve others, but end up meeting only our needs. We claim to live in a way that honors Christ, but we do not take him to work, school, or home. We believe that the gospel can transform lives, at least for those who need it, not us. Forgive us the presence of peace. Instead of grumblers, may we be ambassadors of grace. Instead of continual complaining, may we carry compassion to the hurting. Instead of whiners, may we be workers of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, to reach out and bring the kingdom of God to everyone we meet.
Scripture is taken from Exodus 16, verses 2 through 4 and 9 through 15. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, I am going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. And that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instructions or not. And then 9 through 15. Then Moses said to Aaron, say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining. And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God. In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, what is it? For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, it is the bread that the Lord has given for you to eat. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And one more time, family, will you pray with me? Oh, come, Holy Spirit, come. Come rest upon this space and this place. Rest within us, through us, near us, all around us. And may the words from my mouth may not just be my words, but may they be infused with that spirit. May they take root in us and may they bear good fruit. In our divine brother's Jesus' name I say, amen. So last week we talked about enough, having enough monetarily, emotionally, spiritually. And that reflection led me to a similar kind of sermon. What does it mean to have emotional or spiritual debt? How do we fill ourselves back up because so many of us have been running low for such a long time? How do we get back on track? I want to invite you to remember a time when you were just filled with joy and wonder. I want you to remember a time of ecstasy and innocence. I want you to recall something or some experience that just felt so beautifully and authentically otherworldly. I invite you to remember a time you experienced God. I've always loved nature. I'm not so much a sleeping under the stars kind of girl, but give me the mountains, the lake, and a cabin, and I'm at total peace. A few weeks ago, my family and I went up for our annual summer trip to Deep Creek, Maryland. Now it's not far, it's not fancy, but it's a memory that I will absolutely cherish. As you know, my oldest daughter, Lotus, is going off to college in just 2 weeks, and my younger daughter is starting high school. We're all in this moment of transition. All of our lives are about to change. And on this trip, I couldn't help but be really present in that understanding. We may do this again, but it'll be different. This trip felt like a beginning, but also an ending. A friend of my wife, she owns this cabin in Deep Creek, and she lets us use it at no charge. It's a beautiful cabin nestled way back, and I do mean way back into the woods. There's like actually no road, it's just dirt, and I was terrified when we got there. But surrounded by nothing but wilderness and wildlife. I mean, it really was magical. So wake up and hear a babbling brook, birds, other kind of scary sounds at night. You know, mountains are sacred. All throughout the Old and New Testament, important events happen on mountains. In the Bible, on the mountains is where heaven and earth meet. Biblical mountains are places where God dwells and humankind encounters God. They're a significant place that symbolize strength, majesty, and divine presence. Mountains are often associated with spiritual revelation and encounters with God. I mean, think about Mount Sinai, where we get the Ten Commandments and the Transfiguration on the Mount of Olives. Somehow those elevated landforms serve as powerful settings for key biblical events. As I said, I love mountains. What I love to experience is that early morning mountain mist. Guess what I'm talking about? They're up there, it's like foggy and cloudy and weird and beautiful and wondrous. Something about it draws you in. That mist feels like it's that thin veil between heaven and earth, that liminal space where God can be known, almost touched. Every time I experience it, I'm transfixed. Such a weird and wonderful gift from God. It makes me ask that question, what is this? Just like those Israelites in the wilderness, I wondered, what is this substance from the heavens? Have you ever been so moved by God's majesty that you just ask, God, what is this? What am I experiencing? What am I feeling? What is this? Well, here in Exodus, we find Moses and those newly freed Israelites are quite far from a mountain. In fact, they are in the wilderness just weeks after crossing the Sea of Reeds. And they've begun their long journey to the Promised Land. Now, the people begin to complain about their situations. They're not so pleased with Moses and Aaron. While they had been freed from Pharaoh, they were struggling with what it means to be free. See, under the enslavement, they got used to their chains and everything that went along with it. Pharaoh told them when to eat, when to sleep, when to work. Pharaoh was violent and greedy. And in ancient Egypt, Pharaoh was even considered a god. And the Israelites had grown accustomed to their imprisonment. And when a person is denied their right to self-determine, to self-advocate, when one is unable to exercise their own free will, to have free thoughts, it's like a soul injury. And they can fall into a kind of spiritual debt. They can fall into a kind of emotional debt due to their denial of feeling that, due to the denial of having human emotions to feel, to cry, to love, to self-realize, to self-actualize. Enslavement makes prisoners and captors both less human. Because God calls everyone to these mountains that we can feel, we can experience. And God wants that mountaintop moment for everyone, both freely, the freed and the captors. Now the Israelites did not know what they were missing during their enslavement. So when Moses gives them their first taste of freedom, they complain. They don't understand the divine magnitude of the gift that has been given to them. The Israelites say to Moses, if we don't die in the Lord's hand in Egypt, hear how confused they are. They would have rather had death than freedom. But when freedom came, they had to ask the question, what is this? This story is part of a larger collection of texts in which Israelites complain or murmur against Moses and Aaron, and also before God. This is the pattern that gets established, right? Things get a little tough and the people complain. This strand within the broader wilderness story portrays a common human characteristic of not being satisfied with what we have. The grass always looks a little bit greener on the other side. Rather than judging the Israelites for their lack of understanding, let us use this story as an opportunity to hold up a mirror to ourselves and ask, how often do we complain? To each other, to ourselves? How often do we murmur to God? Where are our own spiritual and emotional debts? And how is that tied to our collective freedom? There will always be mountains and valleys and wilderness because God wants us to have full, free, dynamic lives. Liberation is worth fighting for. But it also means that God doesn't only show up on mountaintops, but especially in valleys and wilderness. God shows up. And our God does not show up empty-handed. Whatever that thing is you need, God may send it tenfold, falling from the sky. God shows up, God provides. And we'll be saying, what is this? Telling Pharaoh, let my people go, our God is God of liberation. And as God's people, it is our opportunity and obligation to stand for justice and freedom for all humankind, whether their situation directly impacts you or not, because none of us are free, unless all of us are free. And to that newly liberated Israelites, you know, Moses was a stranger to them at best. Remember, Moses grew up in the Pharaoh's household. They had every reason to not trust him, to not believe him. But God called him to the task of their liberation. They had witnessed and suffered many plagues, and they were orchestrated by God and Moses. They walked across dry land in the middle of the Sea of Reeds. All of this seemed so surreal. So they were waiting for their luck to run out, for this dream to end. They were scared. See, their fear of Pharaoh was larger than their knowledge of God. That's why they had that, that's where that soul sickness, that spiritual debt was. They feared Pharaoh more than they knew God. But God is a God that meets us right where we are. Whether it be on a mountaintop or in the valley or the rainbows or raindrops, God shows up and God provides. Like Moses, many of us may feel like a stranger at best in confronting some of society's most complicated problems. But I offer again, our liberation is tied together. The Israelites come out of their oppression for liberation, and God sent Moses and Aaron to lead them to a bright and bold new future. Once they had what they wanted, it turned out to be this freedom was different than they had imagined. Because this freedom involved more responsibility than they had before. There is a cost to being free. But the spiritual debt of enslavement is far, far, far too much to bear. While they were enslaved in Egypt, all their basic needs were provided for them, even though they suffered under heavy, heavy work and threat to their children. It was difficult, but they knew what to expect. But this newfound freedom, they didn't know about the mountains, the wilderness, about this flaky, shiny substance falling from the sky. See, God will show up and provide. Sometimes we want something so badly only to get what we want and then find out it's different than what we thought. See, freedom is not just about being free. It's also risk-taking and truth-telling. Liberation is downright dangerous, but the alternative is spiritual and emotional debt, and that cost is way, way, way too high. What will it take for us to just trust in God? This world is broken as it is beautiful. Yet there is wonder and joy and innocence. There are poetic moments of sheer majesty and divinity, like those moments in the morning mountain mist. Wherever you find yourself today, whether it be in the mountains or hungry in the wilderness, trust that God shows up. God provides. Look for your what is this moment. Because we are all meant to have one, and we are all meant to be free. Amen. For the gift of life itself, We thank you for making us in your image, for forgiving us when we act as though you have no claim on us, and for keeping us in your steadfast care. We rejoice in Jesus Christ, the only one eternally begotten by you, who was born of your servant Mary, and shared the joys and sorrows of life as we know it. We remember Christ's death, we celebrate Christ's resurrection, and in your beloved community of your church, we await Christ's return at the end of this history. We take courage in abiding in your abiding presence of the Holy Spirit in our midst. We offer to you our praise for women and men and all people of every age who stand as witnesses to your love and justice. With all the prophets, martyrs, saints, and all the company of heaven, we glorify you.
Holy, 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 holy God of love and majesty, the whole universe speaks of your glory, O God Most High. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of our God, Hosanna in the highest.
In the name of the one who sees all and loves all and heals all, let us pray for each other, all of creation. Let us hold one another in the light of the Lord. Let us spread our light of inclusion, of justice, of love, and of reconciliation to all who need healing today, to all who are grieving, to all who need encouragement, reassurance, who all need kindness, who all need that path of heaven. And now, in the name of our divine brother who taught us to pray, let us say the words of the Lord's Prayer together, starting, Our Mother and Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. We remember on that night of betrayal and sin. We remember that night of betrayal. Jesus took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave his disciples saying, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup and said, this is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this, as often as you drink it, remember me. Friends, by eating this bread and drinking this cup, we proclaim Christ's death and celebrate Christ's resurrection and await Christ's coming again.
Amen. Come, Christ Jesus.
Gracious God, we ask you to bless this bread and this cup and all with all thoughts and all your outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Through this meal, make us the body of Christ, the church, your servant people, that we may be salt and light and leaven for the furtherance of your will in this world.
Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, take the bread and break it. Through the broken bread, we participate in the body of Christ.
The cup of this blessing, we participate in the new life that Christ gives. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, all is ready.
Thank you.
Transition is the offertory. You know, God is the giver of all good things, one who fashioned each of us with unique gifts together that make the body of Christ whole. And in gratitude for all that we have received, let us now accept the morning offering.
Thank you.
God, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, lead this space in peace. Amen.